life is not in danger. So thank you all for your tolerance and also for your good wishes for her. Now, I want to say how happy I am to be in a Grange Hall, because I am a Granger. I am a member of the Patrons of Husbandry, and I have my 35-year pin. It's a wonderful organization. It started as a radical farmers organization in the 1860s to protect the farmers from the big shippers and the railroads and so on, the secret handshakes and so on, that were necessary at that time because there'd be goons outside the door. It changed, and with time, the Grange has become something different nationally at the state level, a little different politically than it was before. But at the local level, the Grange is still often the only thing happening in a small town like this for a community organization. In my little town of Grays River, the Grange has been exceedingly important in getting our town water system and getting our covered bridge restored and doing the parks, all kinds of things. And weirdly enough, the master of our Grange right now is Chris Novoselic, who was Kurt Cobain's best friend and the co-founder of Nirvana. And he played with Paul McCartney, Dave Grohl, and Pat Smear in Madison Square Garden on the 12th of December for the Sandy Relief Concert. There's a great picture of him and Paul McCartney on the front page of the New York Times. 5 days later, he was in the Grange Hall playing Home in the Range on Home on the Range and Home on the Grange on his accordion. So he's an unusual person who's able to do that sort of thing. And we're very gifted to have him and to all Grangers. But I want you to know that this organization, though it has some faintly Masonic resonances in its ritual is basically based on the countryside and on agriculture. And we are now exemplifying the several degrees of the Grange in our Grange, which is an old-fashioned way to go through a kind of a play to repeat what the organization's all about. And I was absolutely blown away by the text of these rituals. So for example, and I'm the lecturer of the Grange, which means I'll read a poem or tell a joke or something. It used to be had the lecturer's hour. Now it's the lecturer's minute, if I'm lucky. And what I get to say during the exemplification of third degree is a passage of rhetoric that could have been written by John Muir or William Jacob Holland, or Aldo Leopold, a beautiful language about the land and people's connection with it. So this is a good organization. And though I don't always agree with them at the state and national level on certain issues, at the local level, it's an extraordinarily important thing in our communities around Washington. And Washington's a big Grange state, by the way. So that's just to give you some context as to where you are. And you see these Grange halls around the state, you wonder, what's that? That's weird. Is that like a secret society at Yale, you know, the Skull and Bones or something? No, not at all. It's a really sweet local organization that I joined to hear the local stories of the old-timers, and it worked really well for that. And you'll find a lot of that in my books, Wintergreen and Skytown and Grays River. Goldendale is also a place I love, and I'm glad that we're here in Goldendale. Isn't it a pretty town? Mm-hmm. It's beautiful. And coming up from the river, the late sun today, or late sun for me, because I couldn't get away very early until I determined that Tia was in a good, safe situation for me to go. But the sun on those fields and on the breaks and the angle of repose and the basalt, just beautiful, beautiful place. But also, I had an adventure here on the Butterfly Big Ear. So I've camped twice at Stonehenge. You know Stonehenge, right, mm-hmm. down the bottom of the road? Twice I've camped there. I mean, it's not a campground, but nobody says you can't. So once I camped there in a Ryder truck and had a twin bed across the back of the truck, put the tailgate up and looked out over the gorge. And then during the Butterfly Big Ear, I camped there in my little car, Powder Milk, which is what I came in this time. And then the next day I came to Goldendale, and I was looking for coffers for the greenies. And the next day I found both. I found two of the three. But I came to Goldendale to get some coffee and some oil for my car, and there was a little story. I realized I didn't have a book with me to read at night camping. So I went to this little junk store that had some books, and there was a leatherette-bound paperback. You couldn't see what it was. And I looked at it. I saw this cool fake leather plastic cover. I said, I think I know what that book is. I had a strong feeling I knew what that book was. I said, that's going to be Blue Highways by William Lacy Moon. And, of course, I was... Butterfly Big Ear, my book, Mariposa Road, has a lot in common with that book. It's a big road trip. And I picked it up and opened it up, and that's what it was. And so I read that book through the next few months, reread it, and found some amazing points of contact with my own journey. For example, in one of the early chapters, William leased Heat Moon and Blue Highways camps at Stonehenge. And I've never heard of anyone camping at Stonehenge besides me. So that was cool. So I think of that coming here. And then Indra, you couldn't find Indra today, but I got Indra with me, and so does Richard. And you got your Indra. Why are you covering up your Indra? You got your lantern under a teapot there, or whatever you said. There it is. You're afraid to show your belly on the... But you don't have a belly. You still have a waist. That's the people. And then you had a little Indra there among the Jameses. Now, that's my next thing, is the Jameses. I understand there's a little ceremony to be conducted.
Oh, yes.
So you have the floor.
Uh-oh.
Here comes some Vanessa's.
Vanessa's, yeah.
Thank you, my dear Roman. Thank you, Jasmine. And there is dear Annabella. All three Vanessa's. Did you know these girls are all named Vanessa? And they have their other names too, which is quite wonderful. Now, what is this going to be? I wonder. Okay. They tried to give it to me earlier, and I said, I bet everybody else would enjoy this too. So it might be really embarrassing, I don't know.
Also.
What's that?
It's going to be pretty close, so.
Yeah. Here's two.
That's two. So, one's for you.
Oh, sweet. I think they're going to be caps. No, they're not caps. They're coffee cups.
Oh, wow.
That one's yours.
Is the other one just the same? No.
No, it's
okay.
Not.
I bet I know what's on the other one. Oh, the kookaburra sits in the old gum tree. Kookaburra sits in the old gum tree.
Stop it, you scared me.
So that's the biggest kingfisher in the world, the kookaburra. It is a kingfisher.
It is.
And this is one of the loveliest parrots in the world. And it is the color that Rhiannon is wearing right now.
She's got the gray, too.
I know, I see that. Or this pen that I stole from Amtrak, that's gray and pink also. I like, 1950s pink and gray, right? I love that color combination. And this is a bird called the Galah, G-A-L-A-H, G-A-L-A-H, Galah. And I just absolutely fell in love with Galahs in Australia last year. And they're just the most beautiful, big cockatoo relatives. And they fly around, they land on the lawns, they're not uncommon in the cities. They'll fly en masse at sunset up the rivers in the late sun. It's pink, it's absolutely gorgeous. And I just totally fell in love with them. Thank you, dear. So that's so sweet.
Oh, that's so nice. So we looked all over for flocks to take pictures of. And we couldn't find. They were hard to find. So that's a substitute for the picture. And the kookaburra also laughs, which Tia does all the time.
She does laugh. And it does laugh. I'm going to put them here so people can take a look at them by these wonderful irises, okay? By the way, there's something else about the galah. I was given, when I was there, I fell in love with galahs. Last year I was at a tender for jobs between Northern Queensland and Tasmania. And one of them, there were a number of Aboriginal writers, and a woman named Ali Kabi Ackerman is a wonderful Aboriginal writer, and she saw that I love galahs, so she gave me a little figurine of galahs, and she said, you know what that means, don't you? I said, no, and she said, in Australian vernacular, a galah is an idiot. Because they seem like really dumb birds, but they're not dumb birds. They're smart birds, actually. But they seem kind of big and clunky and dumb. And so when I left this one job, there was the ash from Chile, and there was the floods, and I had to shuck and jive and go from boats and trains to greyhounds and ferries. And anyway, I left my galahs there, and I was really, really worried about it. And I called the organizer of the conference I'd gone over for, and she looked all over at my motel and everywhere for my galahs. And later I called her, and I said, I found them in my luggage, really deep in my luggage. She said, Robert, I think you're rather a galah yourself. And And I know I am because Tia said, don't leave home without putting your tabs on. So we were going to go in Tia's car, ride her Subaru, but since she didn't come, I came in my old 1982, now 31 years old this month, Honda, which is a character in my books, named Powder Mill, which now has, as of today, has 414,000 miles. But I hadn't driven it for a little while, and my tabs were sitting on the kitchen counter, along with the new insurance proof. And neither one of them went into the car when I quickly had to jam stuff from Tia's car into my car to come. Woo, 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 woo! In the Columbia Gorge, an Oregon policeman stopped me for expired Washington tabs. What's the deal here? So I practically wept, and I told him my whole story, and I ended up with a warning and him wishing Tia good health and so on and so forth. I'm not above, after 10 years, I'm not above exploiting my wife's cancer for whatever. And so I got off with a warning, but I have to get back. And I'm planning on doing most of my travel at night if I can. And that was a galala. May I have the lights down, Richard, please? Now, I have to tell you two things prior to this talk. One is that this is the talk I was going to give at a membership meeting last year. And I got laryngitis. I've given plenty of talks when I've had colds and try not to cough on people. But I had laryngitis and I had no voice at all. So it's kind of pointless. So I had to cancel. And so this is the talk I was going to give for that membership meeting. Second thing is that I owe this talk in many ways to Jonathan Pelham. I almost said Pellman, which is what our dyslexic friend Jonathan Shepherd calls him. So I call him that too, Pellman. But John Pellman, a few years ago, when I was on the Butterfly Big Year, actually in 2008, I was giving a talk at the Butterfly Fest at the McGuire Center in Gainesville, Florida, where the Lepidoptera Society meeting is happening in a few weeks. And Jackie Miller said she wasn't going to let me use slides. I was the last speaker in America using slides. She said, you can't do it. And I said, well, what am I going to do? And so she got Pelham to scan hundreds of my slides. And I have since learned how to use PowerPoint. And I have used those slides over and over and over in 1,000 different combinations. So John, I owe you to that. And you'll see a lot of those here. However, in the meantime, I have learned how to incorporate pictures from lots of different sources.
Well, so, I think for that, we're in your debt.
What's that?
Never mind.
Okay, I heard that. Thank you. That's, you can't say a nice thing to me twice. I know. By the way, the Lepidoptera Society in Gainesville in about three weeks, and I want you all to know that this is a great opportunity for you here in the Northwest. The Lepidoptera Society has a Pacific Slope branch. It's the only regional subgroup in the country for the Lepidoptera Society. And it is having, when the main Lepsoc meets in the east, it meets in the west. And it's a wonderful opportunity to come and hear a few papers by some gifted Lepidopterists, and mostly in the field. This year it's going to be in the Northwest, about the fourth or fifth time. John and I put it on in Seattle in 85, and it was at Malheur one time, and Grants Pass one time, and at Corvallis once or twice. But this year it's going to be back at Malheur at the field station. It's going to be in mid-August, which is the right time for going up to the top of Steens Mountain to see the endemic butterflies up there. There's, I think, three species that have, or two endemic subspecies there, and one butterfly that we find almost nowhere else in Oregon or Washington, the Polydny sulfur is up there too, and the Shasta blue as well. So it's really, if it's not too dry, it could be exactly right for that. So I hope we'll get the information out on the notice line, right, Heidi? Where's Heidi?
Yes.
Can we get that out on the notice line? And I hope some of you will think of coming and meeting some of the Lepsoc folks there. All right. Thank you. You know this animal. Unlike many Americans, this is the animal we call the monarch, Danaus plexippus. And there's not a person in this room who would not know that species, would not know what it is, would not know what gender that is. Quickly, one, two.
Male.
Gender?
Gender.
Not genus, gender.
Male.
Right. Well, there's one person at least that knows. My old professor, Al Wagner, which, by the way, I owe this entire thing to. If Al hadn't finally signed off on my master's thesis, I wouldn't be here today. If I had told you at that time, Al, that you would someday be in the Butterfly Association, you know, that we would have both been surprised. But thank goodness. But the monarch is not a common butterfly in the Pacific Northwest. The one on the upper frame is the first monarch I ever saw in Washington. I photographed that butterfly in 1970 on Blewett Pass, nectaring on a knapweed on its way south in late summer. People noticed that butterflies looked like that in the spring and the and at various times during the summer, but they look like that in the fall. Summer and fall, and that they look like the butterfly below in early spring when they first saw them. That butterfly I photographed in Sequoia National Park when I was a ranger there in 1969, so that's even older, that photograph. But you see the difference between them. One is absolutely cherry and the other one is tatty. And people began to wonder, what does that imply? How come we see this difference in condition at different times of the year? Now, most people, when they think monarch, they don't even think of a monarch. They think of this, right? You know that's the case. I talk to people all the time, and I've stopped. I never correct them. They say, oh yeah, we have a lot of monarchs here. There's a guy in my community, Grays River, Washington, which is not near Grays Harbor, it's down in the southwest corner, who used to always tell me about all the monarchs he saw, and he saw more last year, but not so many this year. I didn't correct him because I knew they were swallowtails, but the point is, he's seeing butterflies, right? And Vladimir Nabokov said, I am astonished how little the ordinary person notices butterflies. And it's true. So I'm thrilled when people notice butterflies at all. They can be brought along, but if you just correct them up front, oh, you don't see monarchs, you know, then that might turn them off altogether. So just say, they're not so common here, and then maybe eventually tell them it's really swallowtails that they're seeing. Again, on knapweed, this is the biggest two-tailed double tail I've ever seen in Washington. Tia photographed this one on knapweed up in Okanagan County a few years ago. This is life size. Well, that's a test to see how many of you are asleep yet. Not yet, okay. Now, because of the condition in the spring and the condition in the fall, people began to think of that perhaps monarchs were migrating. I'm talking now back quite a while. Remember that in the late 18th century, Thomas Jefferson and Gilbert White corresponded across the Atlantic over the question of whether swallows hibernate under the mud. Because they hadn't imagined their migration. So it was about 100 years after that C.V. Reilly and a few others began to imagine that perhaps monarchs were actually migrating. And we know now, of course, that they do, and much more about that later. But first of all, let's get over the idea that a lot of people have the idea that all butterflies migrate. They say, how are the butterflies doing? How are their flyways? You know, they think of all butterflies migrating because they've heard about monarchs. The other thing possible is that people think that only monarchs migrate. And that's not the case. Now, that's using migrate in the broad sense. In fact, monarchs may very well have the only true bird-like migration in North America among butterflies. But there are other butterflies that migrate in the sense of coming in and going out. We should more properly call them immigrators and emigrators. So one of our primary emigrators is the one you saw the larvae of today, the California tortoiseshell. And you know that its larvae feed on mountain balm, is that cool name we found recently for this one? Ceanothus volutinus. Look at the shine on it. That's because of the oils, the essential oils that give that buckbrush, that particular kind of buckbrush, its very strong, sweet, pronounced smell. The one on the right is Ceanothus interregimus, the very purple form that's prominent. Here it's only kind of a pale mauve or white in Klickitat County, but down in the Klamath Siskiyou, it gets really purple. That's why they call it mountain lilac in California. But the California tortoiseshell, of course, feeds on those. And then, hey, Alex, thanks for coming, man. Good to see you here. And you know what happens? It's a butterfly that has a biology much like that of the tansy ragwort moth, the cinnabar moth, that was imported to feed on cinnabar moth to control it, right? Tansy ragwort to control it. Let me start over again. The cinnabar moth, Pteria jacobii, was imported from Europe to try to control the tansy ragwort plant, also from Europe, called Senecio jacobii, right? But a biocontrol only works if it eats itself out of house and home, if it really devastates the population that the plant is feeding on. Most herbivores don't do that. They have more of a steady state. So a good biocontrol has the kind of biology that the California tortoiseshell has, which is to absolutely devastate its host plant. And up by Mount Adams, a few years ago, this is what we found, was defoliated ceanothus. And in these several years prior to the current couple, when we haven't seen many tortoiseshells, we had a number of years of outbursts in various parts of the country when the California tortoiseshells would defoliate the ceanothus of different species. And then if you went into the stand, you would see that it looked like Christmas. They were just absolutely hung with the ornaments of the chrysalides with their silver bangles and the caterpillars in their J form. That's pretty exciting. But then a few days after that, or 10 days or so, you'd have vast numbers of California tortoiseshells coming out and bursting out. And those are the kinds of temporarily unidirectional, but on the whole non-directional migrations, so-called migrations that we see of that species. But it's the kind of migration where they're relieving pressure on the home territory, or they're like lemmings, and they blast out, and they fly up, and so they're seen in the high mountains a lot. And so every year I get letters and emails and reports of monarchs migrating at Mount Hood. Ben, how are you? Good to see you. Flying over Mount Hood, Mount Rainier, all these places. And of course, they're always California tortoiseshells. They even fly over into the west side. And since we have an increasing amount of ceanothus down the Columbia with warming, they'll breed there to some extent. They'll breed on ornamental ceanothus. And then they fly on down and they hit the ocean. And now Mike Patterson in Astoria has noticed a big movement of them down the coast in the fall. What they're doing is they're hitting the ocean and just keep flying. But they're not going anywhere. They're going to die off for the most part. That's one kind of so-called migration. Then there's another kind that we experience in the Northwest, and that's the sort that's typified by the
lady.
Painted lady, exactly. And that one is another butterfly that we don't see every year. Some years we see none. Most years we see some. Some years we see many. Some years they come north in such large numbers that they have closed down I-5 in California, not in Washington. Although I did hear that the Sherman Pass Highway was once closed in Washington because of California tortoiseshell. Yeah, I think you turned
out. Newcomer.
A newcomer had that report. You're absolutely right. So vast numbers of painted ladies will come in certain years. But that's a totally different kind of a thing. That is a buildup of numbers in the south, that is to say Mexico, Arizona, Texas, where they're able to overwinter. They feed on thistles and other plants. And then if the conditions are right, and if the nectar conditions are right in the spring particularly, in other words, enough moisture, and then if flight conditions are decent, so they don't hit a cold front every 10 minutes, then we can have large numbers coming north. And then we have a series of generations in the north. And we now know that there is some southerly movement, but it's unclear how much. But there's certainly nothing like monarchs where the whole population shifts and they're big overwintering. John?
You know that they've been detected southbound now by a special low-frequency radar.
I've heard that. Yes, right. I saw that paper.
And there's every reason to believe that the reason why we're not seeing southern migration is because they're like 150 feet in the air.
It's entirely possible. And monarchs are too. But you know, the thing is, the difference is that monarchs, as you'll see, they fly very high too, oftentimes, but they'll come down at night. You'll find the overnight bivouacs, but you never find painted lady bivouacs going south in the fall, nor are there any known overwintering populations. So are painted ladies evolving toward a true migration like monarchs, or are they evolving toward a farther north survivorship every year? Maybe both, who knows, but we do know now we've had one or two winter records of painted ladies, and we've had one or two winter records of West Coast painted ladies, and of American painted ladies. And so it's entirely possible that this entire genus of butterflies is undergoing a certain amount of shift toward the north. We know it is the case with red admirables. John and I used to argue ad infinitum about whether red admirables overwinter in the north or not. And they do in England to some extent, but now more and more and more. And now it's becoming common here too. So these are animals that don't have a hard freeze diapause, but they do have an increasing ability to overwinter farther north. So you get these shifts north and south, but you get shifts north and south with mourning cloaks. I've seen mourning cloaks flying over Dallas Pass in Oregon in numbers in the fall. There are quite a number of butterflies. In fact, Nabokov, whom I mentioned earlier, was the first person I heard from Remington to estimate that maybe 15% of the American butterfly fauna come in the springtime and are possibly not there over the winter, or in very low numbers, but their influence in the north, John.
Well, you know, I didn't know this about Florida, but you know, Virginiensis is a winter butterfly there. They leave in like June, and you don't see them until, you know, September or October.
So they probably come back.
It's a reverse kind of thing.
Yeah. So butterfly migration in North America is a whole lot more complicated than we ever imagined. And yet, that's exciting that we don't know it all. And we can say that the monarch is the sole species that we know of, in North America at least, in which the entire North American population, and by North America, excuse me, North America in the Pelhamian catalog says north of Mexico. The monarchs north of Mexico, well, again, with the possible exception of Florida and some southern things that's changing down there, the entire population removes itself in the autumn and goes elsewhere, and then refills the following year. And none of the other species do that in the same reliability. Right? Would you agree with that, John? So it really is an almost, in many ways, bird-like migration, and that's quite remarkable. By the way, a certain amount of what I'm telling you tonight is about is general monarch biology and conservation, but I'm going to be getting to the specifics about the Northwest, which is not a talk I've given to this group before. So, it was known pretty early on, but not very early on, that monarchs overwinter in California. And by pretty early, the very first records were in the 1850s, and there's a few things in the 1860s, a little more in the 70s and 80s, and then in the 1900s we begin to get more reports in the booklet written about Pacific Grove, and then John Steinbeck wrote about them in the 40s. But not that much, and certainly no information that goes back to the Spanish missionary period. Surprising. A lot of natural history came out of the 16th and 17th centuries in California. 17th century in California. But not about monarchs. No reports of big monarch gatherings until 1850s or so, which is surprising. But they used to mention primarily pines and to some extent cypresses. John Lane has tried to reconstruct what the old migratory cluster forests may have been prior to the fragmentation of the California coastal redwood, live oak, cypress, pine, and so on forests. But in fact, today, most of the monarchs overwinter in eucalyptus, which is an introduced species that many native plant people have been lobbying to remove from the parks and reserves. And so that sets up a really interesting conflict. That's just like the one in the San Juan Islands with the great island marble that we have there that feeds primarily on introduced European mustards that the Park Service wanted to get rid of. Now we have an endemic butterfly that feeds on those. So we have interfered with the fauna, the flora that is, and consequently the fauna responds to that. And so we have, if it hadn't been for the fact that monarchs made the adaptive shift from being overwintering in the pines and cypresses and redwoods and live oaks to eucalyptus, it could be that the Californian overwintering phenomenon might be extinct, or at least very, very much reduced from what it is today. So you get the eucalyptus control people and the lepidopterists going like this, and sometimes they're the very same people. And boy, do they get skitsy over this thing. It's fun to watch. It wasn't until 1975, astonishingly, this is one of the most recent major discoveries in natural history in the world, that scientists, Mexican or American, United States and Canadian, realized that the great clusters of monarchs were occurring in these transvolcanic ranges of Michoacán and a little bit of Mexico State, in Mexico. And this is where it happens. They fly up these canyons. They gather in vast numbers. Cut that light for just a minute, would you please? Dear, by the wall, cut that one. For most of these pictures, these lights are okay, but cut that one for a minute. So you
left hand switch.
There you go. You can see that better. See, Al, why I like to do that. It's okay for most of the sides. Okay, thank you. Would you put that back on, please, dear? Thank you. So, and then they move up or down the canyons depending on the weather and the temperatures. But that phenomenon in Mexico wasn't discovered until 1975, even though local Tarascans knew about it. So it was like a Colombian discovery, you know. I mean, people knew about North America, right, because they lived here for a long time. But it was discovered in the sense of the larger scientific community knowing about it in 1975, which is remarkable. And these are the kinds of clusters that they hang in. How many here have been to Mexico to see this phenomenon? No one? How many have seen it in California? Which is a fine experience, but far, far less. Okay, that's your assignment.
You go to Mexico.
Get thee down there, see it, and spend as much money as you possibly can, because the alternative income from the monarch ecotourism is very important to protecting those forests. Okay, anyway, this is what they gather in, and as you can imagine, it's a pretty grand sight to see. And they spend the winter there. Now realize that the autumn generation, when they begin to fly south, when they come out of the chrysalis, they are sexually immature. Their glands are not developed. But their wings are, on average, larger than the spring generations, and their muscles are more developed. And they are migratory, truly migratory. They fly south. If you read my book, Chasing Monarchs, which is out of print, but I just got a contract, it's coming back into print from Yale next year, just as Mariposa Road has come back into print from Yale, you'll understand that they fly at a high elevation, rising on the thermals just like Beauty O'Hawks, where's the birders in the room? And they glide, and they have a superb glide ratio, and that's how they're able to cover hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of miles, is primarily through gliding. And then they'll come down for roosting at night and for nectar. When they finally get to their destination, whether it's California or Mexico, they spend the winter primarily torpid. In the springtime, the increasing day length triggers a hormonal response to where their gonads develop and they become hypersexual. And they mate to a high degree and they begin flying north. Instead of gliding and flying high, when they come north, they fly low, looking for nectar, mates, and primarily milkweed to lay their eggs. And so they don't live very long. They die on the way. It's the next generation, the next, and the next that infill the north. So several generations north, only one non-sexual generation south. Urquhart found, who was the first to start the monarch tagging, Professor Fred Urquhart, found that monarchs can develop from egg to adult in 25 days under optimal conditions, 55 days if it's cold and wet. Big difference. Does that sound reasonable to you, David?
Yeah.
So the number of generations it takes to fill the north may vary. So while they're torpid in Mexico in the wintertime, if they withstand the predators, and there are some that deal with the toxins in monarchs, or bite it to see if they're very toxic or not, or if they withstand drowning in the moisture that they must come down and try to find every day, particularly in Mexico, these are going to be some great fossil deposits in the future, like Florissant, Colorado. Then they fly north again in the way I described. And now we get to the Northwest, because what happens? We know that they infill most of North America. Well, we know that they do not infill most of the Northwest. So what is the picture for monarchs in the Northwest? Well, this picture comes from Guppy and Shepherd's great book, The Butterflies of British Columbia. And it shows essentially the picture. It doesn't show all of Oregon, but that's Columbia, isn't it? Okay, so here's that. Anyway, scattershot. Took a shotgun and shot without looking. That's kind of the records you get in the Northwest. Except that, basically east of the Rockies Trough, east of the Puget Sound and basically east of the Cascade Crest, with a scattering of records around Puget Sound because that's where the majority of Lepidopterists has been. And these records, by the way, are primarily prior to the phenomenon of wedding releases, which we'll get to later on. So these are probably, for the most part, natural records. But you see there's a bunch of them in the Willamette Valley and a bunch around Puget Sound where the Lepidopterists were and a few other concentrations. But notice something else. Do you see anything else that strikes you? Along the rivers is right. They use the rivers a great deal. And this is something I found in my chasing monarchs exercises. They use the rivers. Look at that. They use the rivers a lot, and they go a lot farther because of the rivers. Also, they go way beyond the range of milkweed. Because milkweed, as you'll see in a slide in a few minutes, doesn't go nearly this far north. Not nearly. Goes about here. And certainly there's none over here, none over here. But nobody told them that. So if you have a monarch migrating north, and the winds are good, and the conditions are good, and the breaks are good, they're going to go as far as they can go. And if they find milkweed, fine. And that's why if somebody has milkweed in their garden in Seattle, or as John found, milkweed that became established adventitiously along the railroads, in the railroad yards of Seattle, there have been monarchs down there because they'll come in just randomly. It's not random. There's a different word from random called stochastic, and all it means is stuff happens. It's not really random because it's dependent upon many variables.
They spell stuff differently.
Pardon?
They spell stuff differently.
Yeah, they spell stuff differently. And you can never model this, but it just means that because of all the influences that are available, they will go as far as they can go. And so some of them end up in the west, beyond milkweed. And milkweed stops in the west, as you see in a moment, down about here. And they'll still end up there. So if there happens to be a milkweed there, they might find it. So that's kind of the picture of monarchs in the Northwest in general. Now let's look at the states. Here's Oregon, from the John Hinchliffe atlases that John Pelham and I and John Shepard and others took part in helping to develop for the years, a group called the Evergreen Aurelians that developed these maps over the years. And again, it looks pretty much like scattershot. But it's not really scattershot, because here's the Willamette Valley, the John Day River, the Deschutes River, the Owyhee River. Again, you have a lot of adherence to rivers. And the Oregon Lakes, notice the Oregon Lakes District down here, that's important. A lot of records there. How about Washington? Here are the Washington records as of, what, 90, 93, 95, something like that?
Before that.
I think it was published in 93, wasn't it? I think it's 93 where the Inchula Falcons is. So fewer records in Oregon, of course. Puget Sound, where the collectors are, and the watchers. Here where I live. here where Jim Reed lives, here where various other Lepidopterists live, but also again on the rivers, the Snake, the Columbia, the Yakima, the Okanagan, and so on. So that was the distribution. We have more records than that now, of course, and David James, whom I'm going to speak about in a little while, has added a great deal of knowledge to this. And David, I'm expecting you'll want to say a word later on at some point. So, now we begin to ask the question of what limits the distribution of monarchs and why should they, and I'm a butterfly biogeographer. That means a person who is interested in why things occur here, why they don't occur there, and why the heck don't they occur there. That's the whole point of biogeography. And the first question is host plant dependence. The first answer is host plant dependence. These are the two oldest depictions of monarchs in North America. Literature. The one on the left is Abbott, from Abbott and Smith, the rare Lepidoptera of Georgia from 1787. We have in the room the supreme Lepidoptera bibliographer in the country, by the way. I hope you know that. John, again, the date for Abbott?
1797.
Thank you. And the one on the right is Catesby, Do you have any idea? Bullfrog, Reina Cates Viana, is really Cates Viana?
There were several editions. I think 1639 was one of the earliest.
That early, wow. So those are the very early illustrations, but notice they're both, well, the one on the right is with an orchid for some reason. But the one on the left of Abbott's accurately shows it with the southern tropical milkweed. And in fact, the monarchs are co-evolved with milkweeds in such a way that they absolutely depend upon that family, as you know. They're not camouflaged because, of course, they take in the toxins in the milkweed, the cardiac glycosides, that make them highly distasteful to their prey. And so they're brightly striped, so the birds learn what they look like once they take a bite. And those, what look like antennae or tubercles, to my knowledge, they do not have a physiological function. I've come up with a scientific term for those. It is bogus doodads. And I think the bogus doodads simply increase the conspicuousness of the distasteful larva. And of course, what that leads to is the most famous picture in American biology. These are the great studies that Lincoln Brower and Jane Van Zandt Brower conducted at Amherst in the 50s and 60s, in which they tested hungry, but not starving, naive monarchs. In other words, monarchs that had not been exposed to monarchs in the past. And they were naturally hungry. And they were given a monarch, and the jay eats it, masticates it. They don't have teeth, but they do that with their bill. Spits out the wings, which is commonly the case with birds eating butterflies, not always. And then you get to picture number four, and the bird looks a little bit concerned. Picture number five, more than concerned. And picture number six, I can only caption it, hey prof, can we start this experiment again? But it's too late, because here comes the most famous picture in American biology, the famous barfing blue jay. This is for you guys especially. Thank you for staying up for this. Thank you to your parents for allowing you to do so. The famous barfing blue jay, followed by the equally piquant and fetching but seldom remarked upon retching blue jay. And that's probably where the learning is really taking place. You know, it's like, don't eat those anymore. Don't be a galah, you know, don't eat monarch. And finally, you have the educated blue jay, complete with cap and gown. And they will never eat a monarch again. And that's driven a great deal, of course, of mimicry in other species that look like monarchs, such as the vicewort, which might or might not have their own toxicity or distastefulness. Monarchs, by the way, I mean vicewort, used to be thought to be perfectly tasty, right? All the old books said monarchs were tasty. I mean, vicewort were tasty. But one of Lincoln's students found that vicewort, which feed on what? As caterpillars? Willows, which is in the genus Salix, which is in the family Salicaceae, which contains what secondary plant substance? Salicylic acid, which is a component of what?
Aspirin.
Which tastes how?
Bitter.
Blech. Right, see? So viceroys also have a degree of unpalatability, and so viceroys and monarchs are probably Mullerian mimics, not Batesian mimics. Not with a tasty model and an untasteful, distasteful mimic, but they're both distasteful, and so they play both ends against the metal and really confuse the birds. Sorry, I pointed a laser at someone.
Is anybody following?
Not yet. Might be a delayed reaction. So, monarchs require milkweed. So what milkweed are we talking about here? We only have two species in Washington. One of them is the showy milkweed, which is Asclepias speciosa. But it's instructive because the John Day Dam and the old aluminum plant, which is Deerlit, is the westernmost site in the Columbia Gorge that I've ever found for this species.
And those told senior moment that I ate?
It's every moment for me, man. I don't know about you. I guess so. That's a generous term. But this is the showy milkweed, and it's very much like the common milkweed of the East. And in fact, there are introductions of common milkweeds westerly now, and they are hybridizing, so there are some confusing populations. The other species that we have in Washington, it's actually more widespread in the south, but not as much in the north, is the, it's called the narrow-leaved milkweed. What are some other names for it? The
common name, or?
Narrow-leaved is a common name. Mexican whorled milkweed is another. But its scientific name is Asclepias fascicularis. The other one is Asclepias speciosa. This is Asclepias fascicularis. And they're both equally acceptable to monarchs. I found down in the gorge east of here, a place they're called the fish trap in the book, because I found a lot of them, monarch larvae on both species side by side within inches of each other. I'd quite happily take this species as well. There's another plant that looks a lot like milkweeds, and at least two people in this room have been fooled by it. But it's really Indian hemp, which is in the same, it's in the next family, it's in the next family over, and it's not suitable for monarchs, but it sure looks like a milkweed.
It has been recorded as a food plant.
Has been, yes. And then Sue Morkin did some experiments that showed that they don't really like it. But a couple of us have been fooled by that. So this is the distribution of milkweeds in our area. This is a very rough version of a line. They go up into Canada, up around Kamloops and Penticton, but not much north of that. The Similkameen Valley is their headquarters, going up in there in BC, and then more to the east. That's all speciosa, the showy milkweed. And then in Washington, it's by no means everywhere in there, but it's spotty and patchy, particularly around rivers and lakes and water sources and roadsides. But it has invaginations into the mountains in the Okanagan and the Wenatchee and the is that the Yakima and the Natchez and the various rivers going into the mountains. It goes much farther west in those, but never as far as the crest, to my knowledge. And then in the gorge, as I say, we're about here probably, and showy milkweed stops about here, but fascicularis comes all the way west to Underhill. Bingen, that's the westernmost place we found monarchs. Tia found the base of a monarch chrysalis on fascicularis in Bingen. But the plant goes almost to the Skamania County line, but not doesn't cross it to my knowledge, right about here. And then in Oregon, both species are spotty in all these places. And then speciosa comes up the Willamette Valley as far as Salem, Eugene and Salem, and there's been quite a bit of effort lately to enhance the milkweed populations, restore them in the Willamette Valley. But in the Klamaths, the Warner Mountains, and whatever L stands for, the Snake River Basin, the Owyhee Malheur, and so on, there are some other species. And so they include Cordifolia down in the Klamath Siskiyou, Cryptoceras, which is a very cool looking rhinoceros headed milkweed in the Malheur Owyhee. And then almost all the rest in the northwest is showy milkweed and narrow-leaved milkweed. So how do they respond to it, and how do we know where they go and where they've been? Well, back in the 1930s, Fred Urquhart at the University of Toronto started tagging experiments. It really got going in the 40s and 50s when they got some decent adhesives for these things. And they started having thousands of volunteers all over the country to record the recoveries of tags. And there have been probably hundreds of thousands of releases and some tens of thousands of recoveries. Used to be that the tags were put over the forewing like this. You had to rub some scales off from around the costa. And it was a little bit tricky. And it was possible to accidentally stick together the hindwing and the forewing. And one time, I actually stuck an antenna down inside of there, and it was flying around in circles. I had to catch it and use my Swiss Army knife to relieve it, and it was fine after that. But the great fun of this is that I discovered during the Chasing Monarchs exercise that you can use the tag to splint the costa. Twice I caught monarchs whose costa, the leading edge, the strut of the kite, and you know how thick that leading edge vane is, the costa, was broken. They had no chance of flying, let alone migrating. But I found I could split it with the tag, and they flew just fine after that, so that was lots of fun. Nowadays, and David, do you use the little ones in the hindwing, the round ones?
The round ones, yeah.
On the hindwing?
On the hindwing.
So people now stick one on the ventral hindwing that's round, and you don't even have to remove the scales, right?
No, don't use
them. I have no idea how they adhere. I really don't with the scales on there. It's a lot easier now and easier for people to take part in. So after the first number of recoveries, this map evolved and became the map that was a tenet, a canon of American natural history for decades. And every film strip, every book, every movie, every textbook, every slide lecture and so on, you would see this map or a version thereof. And it implied, it didn't imply, it explied that all the monarchs born east of the Rockies went to Mexico. And of course this map, they used to go to here. And then after 1975, we actually knew where. This is Brouwer's best iteration of it in the 90s. And then the Western monarchs all went to the California coast. And you know that old model with who knows what's happening here and no monarchs down here. Well, was that true? Whether or not it was true, it certainly got elaborated through hearsay and repetition. And lots of maps everywhere came up with different versions of it. This is one I found in Mexico that was kind of weird. And actually, it was a little bit closer, perhaps, than these. And this one became prominent. There was a massive movement from the east down to Mexico, which is essentially right. And this massive movement in the west all down to the California coast, with nothing happening in here. That seems strange, because I grew up here, and there were monarchs, and I saw them crossing the high Rockies in both directions. So I began wondering, where did those western Colorado and Utah monarchs go? And so when I was working on chasing monarchs, I decided to actually investigate the data. And these were the data that were available. This is my elaboration on what was available then. The old Urquhart maps, Fred Urquhart, got in the unfortunate habit of shipping monarchs from the east to the west. And then he got a colleague in California who's still at it, shipping monarchs from California elsewhere and releasing them and seeing where they went and then putting those arrows on the map. Do you see any problem with that? Like, can you really take a monarch from California from point A to point B, release it at point B, recover to point C, and say that monarchs from point B would go to point C? No. Did anybody ever study Socrates or Descartes or Plato or anybody who ever tried to talk about logic? That's no way to reason. And yet that's what happened. And so the early maps showed these releases of Urquharts and Cherubinis in British Columbia, way west of Milkweed, going down here, and it showed the range coming all the way up here, everything but Niamey, apparently, which of course is wrong. And it showed nothing down here, yet again, this interesting absence. It did show some movement in both directions here, which is correct. And it also showed, you don't have the benefit of the caption here, the barred lines are releases of Urquharts, and these lines were actual wild monarchs from Boise that were reared by two teachers, Mary Henshaw and Faye Sutherland, who raised thousands of monarchs with their students and released them at the schools, wild monarchs, from there. And some of them were recorded in California. Ah, but Urquhart's maps did not show these. Excuse me, the solid lines are releases. The barred lines are actual wild monarchs. And this is all we had, and these are recent ones. So all we had in the olden days were the Boise monarchs. That's all we had. That was the total database. And some of them went to the southeast and the south, but those were omitted from the Urquhart maps. And so we ended up with this. based on this somehow, when in fact this is all we have for non-transfer recoveries. Now, how you get from this map to this map is astonishing. Nothing other than repetition, hearsay, and repeated myth. And myth doesn't mean a mistake, but in this case it was. So I got kind of wondering, once I detected or investigated what the actual data were available, what really happens? And I started looking at the North American map here. So there's monarchs from all here, and they're ending up down here, and they're ending up here. So is it really true that all these monarchs over here in western Colorado and Utah and the inland northwest are crossing the basin and ranges, contrary to the prevailing winds, contrary to the water courses, to end up at the California coast? How much sense does that make? Or, in fact, are they following the water courses that primarily trend south? And are there western monarchs going to Mexico as well? And that's what instigated the Chasing Monarchs project, because I felt the only way you're going to answer these questions is to try to follow them. Well, I can't fly. Gravity is not my friend. One person tried to do, you know, this big monarch thing with an ultralight. Remember that a few years ago, Pocatelli or whatever his name was? That was cool. That was made a cool story. But, you know, the prop wash would be a problem, as would gravity. He didn't actually follow them or discover anything. It was a great PR thing for monarchs. So in the time of the ripening of the milkweed, Tia came with me first. For the first couple of weeks, we started up in British Columbia, the northernmost breeding grounds of monarchs, in this high Similkameen Valley. And we found the monarchs coming out of their chrysalides in the late summer and preparing for migration, tanking up on milkweed and goldenrod and rabbit brush and any other, and purple vetch and any other nectar plant available, and then taking off. What sex?
Yeah.
Well, you're asking your question.
What gender?
Male.
Right. And then I followed. Now I can't fly, so what I would do is follow the monarchs as far as I could on the ground and then detect their vanishing bearing, not their heading. Because if you look at an airplane, the heading and the direction they fly can be very different, right? Depending on the winds, you'll see an airplane pointed that way and it's really flying that way. And it's true with butterflies too. It's the vanishing bearing that counts, the actual direction the organism is going, not the direction it's pointed. And so I'll come back to the actual content of this graph later on, but it was the vanishing bearings that became my datum for following the monarchs. And it wasn't only my datum for a couple of papers that came later, but it was also my running orders for the literary and road trip exercise that this was. So they started coming down to the Sun Lakes. This is the Sun Lake State Park where Jonathan Pelham discovered the one of the great But going down the snake, and the snake starts to go more easterly. So the monarchs did too. So what I discovered was they're not slaves to direction. They have a sun compass, we know this from experimentation, but they have several systems, and one of them is a visual recognition of landscape features, because that's where nectar will be and where the roosts will be. So they followed the snake until we got to Burley, Idaho. And you know what happens in Burley, Idaho? The snake goes north, toward the Tetons, where it's actually coming from. But they're not going to turn north in October. No way. So at that point, they diverged from the snake. They went over Adobe Pass, straight south, and into the Great Basin. Now, in the Great Basin, there aren't any features anymore. They're nectaring on rabbit brush, which was their bread and butter through much of the American West. And they took me into, of all places, the Bonneville salt flats. What are they going to do there? And so, but I was reading Edmund Way Teal, his great travels across America, and I found that in 1952, Teal found monarchs in the Bonneville salt flats. So I didn't lose hope, and I camped at the only place I could in the highway rest area on the freeway. And there were 17 big Russian olives in planters for shade. And I stood in the salt flats at 9 in the morning when it got warm enough, looked at them. I stood there for an hour and from 8 to 9, and at 9 o'clock, when the temperature hit, I think, 66, off of the biggest Russian olive rose, the biggest monarch I'd ever seen in my life. And they were overnighting in the Russian olives in the highway rest area. And it went. It rose on a thermal, just like the hawks, got about 150 feet, left the thermal, and went south. I said, right on. That wasn't supposed to happen. And then they took me down through the mountains, the Beaver Mountains of Utah, and down through the Pink Sand Dunes, and through the desert southwest, where we had no records for monarchs. And eventually into the Saguaro country. In other words, that territory that was an absolute blank on the Urquhart map and the Brouwer map and so on. And on October so-and-so, 1996, I had monarchs about a quarter mile north of the Mexican border, flying south, west of the Rocky Mountains. And the next year, some colleagues of mine actually saw them cross the border at Sisabi. And since then, the Arizona Monarch Project has repeated this result over and over and over, and they actually now have, well, I'll get to that in a minute. So that was the result of this long trek. They said, well, this is what I mostly found. And that's completely contrary to what anybody had expected. Now, it's not true that none of them went to the West Coast, because the only one that I tagged, and still to this day, the only, there are two monarchs tagged in Washington recovered in California, right, David? Yeah. You had one, right. And I had one. Yeah. And this one was one that David Branch caught and I tagged, and it was recovered by kids in Santa Cruz 1 month after. I caught it on September 27th, or tagged it, and it was recovered on October 27th. And it was, the kid found it. It was probably hit by a car, was injured. He tried to save it. It died anyway, so he put it outside. The ants got it. And then he noticed the tag, thank goodness. And then he called the number, and we got the record. So we do definitely have Northwest monarchs that go to California. There's no question of that. But in fact, this is what I found. This was in the book, but it's in a couple of papers that have come out since. This is in a forthcoming paper on the subject I'm giving you tonight. There was a meeting last year in Minnesota on monarch butterfly and biology and conservation. It's the sixth one that's been held, MonCon 6. And in the proceedings of that conference, this paper will appear. And these were my data. The largest proportion of monarchs that I found were, in fact, heading south in the west. Only a few heading southwest and west. And this one, it was really funny, because that was one monarch that was caught up in a migration of snout butterflies. There were thousands of snout butterflies moving northeasterly, and there was one monarch that got caught up in them and went with them. That was pretty funny. So this brings us to a reconsideration of the model of monarchs that has been presented to us for half a century. This is the old model. This is one hypothesis that, in fact, some of the Western monarchs are going down here after all. And hypothesis two is that instead of going down to Michoacan, that these Western ones are going to a new site in the Sierra Madre Occidental. But that's almost certainly not the case, because it's way too dry there. There's no oil mill furs, which is what they overwinter in Mexico. So in fact, it seems, particularly now that there have been recoveries from Arizona, which turns out to have quite a few monarchs, not none, there have been recoveries down here in Michoacan. And so what this leaves us with, as far as the Northwest goes, is the possibility, and in fact I now think the likelihood, that we both receive monarchs from and donate monarchs to California, particularly in the western part of these states, that is the western part of the milkweed range, and very likely Mexico. And that's a very different view from what we had of Northwest Monarchs in the past. We don't yet have the tagged Washington Monarchs recovered in Mexico. Ah, but stay tuned. So, it was a huge satisfaction to me and relief. And, you know, you like to think that the stuff you do has some sort of a impact, and it usually doesn't, but sometimes it does. As John's found with this catalog, you know, so many people now have such a much better understanding of North American butterflies because of John's catalog, which is something that we should recognize every time we meet, by the way. It's admired all over the world, and everyone in every country wishes they had a catalog of that exactitude and authority. But this was an enormously satisfying moment for me when the new map came out from Monarch Watch, which is the big Monarch website group, and it showed these arrows. And when I saw those arrows appear on their map, I said, yes, this was worth doing. So, the important thing is not simply knowing a better idea of the migration. Sure, we want to know that scientifically and as curious people, but it's about conservation, because it used to be thought that the California monarchs had to be conserved from their threats, which are primarily high land prices and removal of eucalyptus and sprays and all sorts of things that happen on the California coast, versus the Mexican monarchs as two different systems. And now we know that they are all part of one system. And why should we ever be surprised by greater connectedness in nature? We should never be surprised by that. And that's exciting. So that brings us to what are the big threats to monarchs? And one of them has to do with genetically modified crops. Now, this is just what people are talking about currently with Monsanto, is that the bill in Congress, which has largely been passed to prevent any citizen lawsuits against GMO crops. That's what that's about. Which isn't even constitutional remotely. But Monsanto has had an enormous impact on monarchs in the Midwest, which is where the majority of monarchs breed. We know this from heavy hydrogen studies, detecting their isotopes from the rainwater of the Midwest and from the monarchs in Mexico. The vast majority of monarchs breed not on the Atlantic coast, but in the Midwest. And in fact, the monarchs of the Midwest mostly arise from opportunistic milkweed that grows around the edges of fields. And has not been a problem, primarily. With the vast areas of corn and soy, we still have lots of monarchs and lots of milkweed, until Roundup Ready soybeans came along. Not even as much the BTK corn, which is a threat and it can kill monarchs, but it's the Roundup Ready soy that has caused a vastly greater use of Roundup throughout the Midwest, which is also sold by Monsanto. And that's caused a huge reduction in the number of monarchs coming out of the Midwest, reflected in the fact that the number of monarchs in Mexico this last winter was the lowest ever in all the years recorded. Only 2 hectares of monarchs. That's all the monarchs of North America and North Mexico concentrated into 2 hectares. Can you believe that? So this is what the monarch concentrations are like in Mexico at their best. It's a world of monarchs, it's a wall of monarchs. But the problem is that down in Mexico now is that one person's butterfly tree is another person's livelihood. And I know all about that because I come from a turned-down timber town in southwest Washington. We've heard it all before with spotted owls. And these are not evil people. These people who make their living by the conversion of pulp on the timberlands. And, you know, that's what our books are printed on, is the pulp of the trees. So it's not bad people, but when you get too much removal of pulp from a particular rare resource, we know that the rare species, like Johnson's hair streak, suffer. And so that's the big problem in Mexico, and Lincoln Brower has devoted himself to reforms in Mexico to protect those forests, and there actually have been strides there. But it's difficult with what's going on in the north with the GMO crops. Even if we reform what's going on in Mexico, we might have problems. And then the third problem is climate change. Here we have a forest with mountain pine beetle killed trees, right? Wrong. That's what it looks like. Those are monarchs! There's an estimated 20 million monarchs in that picture. Problem is that the fields down below where people are growing corn to subsist on at 10,000 feet in the mountains were monarch forests 10 years before that. And there's been a vast reduction. Remember that canyon I showed you? That canyon doesn't look like that anymore. It's patchy, it's really fragmented. There's still enough to hold the monarchs more or less. But the fact is, the monarchs, as you remember from what I said earlier, shift up and down the canyon depending on the temperature in a given year. And as they lose the suppleness of the forest to hold them down here or up there, when it's only patchy, they don't have as much room to move around. The other thing is that as it gets warmer, they're moving farther and farther and farther up the mountain, and the mountain only goes so far. So the monarchs have these three things that they're working against, and one of them is the poisoning of the milkweeds in the north, one of them is the cutting of the trees in the south, and the other one is global climate change. Now, these are the people who coexisted with the monarchs for thousands of years and could continue to do so with modest use of those timberlands if industrial forestry from a large scale, and some of it cartel driven, wasn't involved. And they're the people whose livelihoods are intermingled with those of the monarchs. And those are the children that, when we go to the monarch forest, we'll find their signs left behind. Por favor, no maltrates mi hogar, si lo haces, donde vivere this place. Basically, don't mess with our habitat. If you do, where are we going to go? And that led to the other question, that where are the monarchs going to go in the north if we don't have milkweed? They've got to have the milkweed. And that's why I'm so heartened and happy by the efforts that are taking part. I don't know if we're ever going to defeat the great beast of Monsanto. It seems unlikely. So people are fighting back in other ways by planting a lot more milkweed in a lot of other places. Native milkweed for its particular place. There are some dangers in shifting milkweed around because monarchs are co-evolved with particular local milkweeds that have a different, as Lincoln Brower calls it, spectrum of palatability, and get less palatable milkweeds and more palatable milkweeds, and you don't want to mix the two. Or you can diminish the monarch's ability to resist their predators. But the Xerces Society and some other groups are working hard to rear vast quantities of native milkweed seed in different regions and to get it spread around to the appropriate places. And that gives me hope. I have hope in several ways. And one of the biggest things that's given me hope recently is a project initiated here in Washington to bring it back to Northwest monarchs in particular. What can we do here? Well, if we don't get any monarchs from either California or Mexico, which has been pretty much the case for a few years, there's not a whole lot we can do with those. But we can prepare the ground so that we understand what monarchs do when they get here, and so that we might be able to prepare a lot more habitat to be appropriate for them in a good year again. And remember, monarchs are insects, so they're resilient, and they can bounce back. And we've seen that happen with monarchs. So by no means, just because the grass's been primarily down, doesn't mean it has to be down to the bottom, because there are fluctuations. So David James has been working with residents of the state penitentiary of Walla Walla. Is that correct, David?
Yep. Incarcerated citizens.
Exactly.
Yeah. One doesn't like that.
I love it.
Oh, you love it.
Okay. It's beautiful.
Well, I thought residents was a good word, or guests. whose lives have been, you know, not easy ones, no doubt, and are culpable for their reasons they're there, but they have hopes and they have aspirations. And David's been working with them to rear monarchs in large numbers and to release them. And these studies are aimed at understanding nectar corridors, understanding migration patterns, enhancing the numbers of monarchs, and enhancing the habitats, as well as the laudable social goal of enhancing the lives of these men and hoping that it'll carry through in their character and their abilities to come. Dave, would you like to say anything more about this program? Would you?
I did mention.
Would you mind standing in the?
I did mention it a little bit last night, so I actually showed that slide, and so I forewarned them, and so I don't think there's too much more I can say, really.
Okay.
I mean, apart from the fact that the whole thing is in its infancy. This is the first year, or last year was the first year, and this year is the second year, and I have high hopes for it in the future. We started off small. I mean, I mentioned last night, you know, 2,500 individuals. And we hope to do more in the future. Yeah, I don't think it's too.
And did you also mention your Coronas and vineyard projects?
Okay, yes.
So we have lots of good things going on here that we can look forward to a brighter future for these butterflies. David, you know, so, express our. And this just thrills me. And it brings me around to one of my favorite logos I've ever seen. And that came out of a Mexican monarch conservation group called Monarca AC. And don't you like that logo? Because it's absolutely true. The future of these creatures, monarchs in the Northwest, and butterflies in general, is in our hands. It's in the hands of the members of WABA and NABA and the Lepidoptera Society and the Xerces Society and the citizens of Goldendale and everybody who cares about their environs. And if we make the right decisions, if we do the right things, if we make the right choices, we hope that we can maintain a world where this is possible. And this is possible. Here's Tia, come to say hi. On our last trip to the Monarchs in Mexico. And let that be the case. But if we make the wrong decisions, we could lose this wonderful butterfly from our fauna. We could lose it from, we could lose the North American migratory monarch phenomenon. Butterfly's not endangered as a species, but the North American migratory phenomenon is definitely threatened. And we could lose that spectacle and that amazing evocation of nature. And not only that, we could lose the opportunity to sometime in our lives see a sky full of monarchs. That's only been reported once in Washington literature, to my knowledge. And that was a Lepidopterist that John and I knew, Don Fritchin. And I've tried and tried to find more detail, but I can't find it anywhere in my files. But he reported once over Bremerton seeing a sky full of monarchs. And he wasn't seeing California tortoiseshells because he knew what he was seeing. No. So, and they didn't even have good IPA in those days. So, and weed wasn't legal. So I think he probably actually saw them. And so perhaps we can all see that again someday. But if we make the wrong decisions, strange things might happen. Thank you very much. It was a long talk, and you've had a long day, but are there any questions? Now I can use
I do have a question.
The devil button.
When is the best time in Mexico to go down? Do they get there in October, or is it later?
October is a little bit early. They're moving then, but you're gambling if you go in October. But really, mid to late November, you'd be probably safe, and then all the way through to early March. They're starting to leave earlier and earlier. It used to be pretty much the spring equinox, but sometimes that's a little late these days. So, you know, Butterflies Remington figured this out. Professor Remington at Yale, who started the Lepidoptera Society, he realized a long time ago that a lot of the things that butterflies do are stimulated by both day length and temperature. Not one or the other necessarily. Because think about it. If it were only temperature, all the butterflies would have hatched about 2 weeks ago when there was a warm day in Western Washington, right? Then they'd all be dead now. They'd be rotting. But if that's one of the factors, and the other one is the increasing day length, then it kind of averages out, and it plays both ends against the middle. And so that's the case with the monarchs also. The equinox makes a big difference in the north as to their flying south, and a big difference in flying north from Mexico. But in California, the breakup of the colonies and the big mass mating rituals takes place quite appropriately around Valentine's Day, not the spring equinox. It is warmer and farther north. So you're safest to go to Mexico by going closer to the midwinter. But then, of course, you have a better chance of foul weather, too. But I've always had good experiences going there in November and December, and actually February can be a very good month. There's no guarantee that you won't get there and find the clouds close and rain and snow and monarchs huddled up. I've known people to go and see nothing but monarchs huddled. Even that's spectacular. But most people who go, if they have 2 or 3 days, will have at least some sun and see the monarchs spreading and flying. And that's what we want to see, but it's actually not the best thing for monarchs. The best thing for them is to stay huddled and torpid the whole time. Because the more they fly, the more they burn up the fat they built flying south. And one of my friends said, they build up fat to fly south? And I said, yeah. He said, where are you going, South America? Thanks a lot, you know. But they're building up their fat on the way south. And if they fly around too much, they get too dry, especially if there's not enough water on the ground. They have to come down for that. They burn up too much fat. And then also, if it gets too cold at night, they freeze. It's a knife-edge thing where they need to stay cool enough to preserve their genes and their fat over the winter, but warm enough not to freeze. That's why a narrow altitudinal range in this one species of tree is what works. And so that's why logging, even if it's only selective logging, opens up the canopy and disrupts that. And consequently, you're probably best off going between about the end of November, early December, and mid-February. Yeah, and I do urge you to go. It's the grandest butterfly spectacle. It's quite wonderful. It's a beautiful place. The village of Angageo, though it was flooded very badly a few years ago, has come back, and it's a charming place. People are kind, and I try to give yourself enough time to go to more than one of the sites, because they're all quite different. Rosario is the most commonly visited, and that has a long string of little tiendas going down. Do you know how many tiendas? They're quesadilla stands and doodad stands and so on. The doodads are important too, because people make monarch art and peddle it. That's all part of an alternative income, so they don't log it. But it's a little more developed, and it's got some concrete stairs going up and a lot of interpretation, and it's the safest place for actually seeing them. Chinqua, on the other hand, is a little wilder. They move up and down the mountain. You might have to walk more or rent a horse. You can't get dusty on the horses. There's a third place called Pyle that's still wild, and it's the one place I've ever been in Mexico, and I've spent a lot of time there. I have three grandchildren in Mexico. It's the one place I've ever been in Mexico that I felt I was experiencing wilderness with a capital W in the North American sense. Pyle. So I'd try to give yourself a week if you go down, try to get to each of these. And then you could drop just off the escarpment to the south and get into tropical butterflies, not very far from the monarchs. That's pretty wonderful too.
As an aside, we are raptor watchers, and so we go to the East Coast quite a bit.
Right.
And spends a lot of time in Virginia, and along the Blue Ridge Parkway, there's a huge monarch migration.
You bet.
Just up there with the, you see the broadwings, and then you see the monarchs.
That's right.
It's really cool.
Yeah, absolutely. They'll fly along ridges, and in fact, there was a paper recently that tried to show that the monarchs are being funneled by the Sierra Oriental and Sierra Madre, Oriental and Occidental. And they're not being funneled by them. They fly on top of the ridge. I've been down there in those states of Mexico, in Nuevo León and so on, and looked up, and they're flying hundreds of feet above the ridge of the Sierra Madre Oriental. They'll follow them, but they're not funneled by them. And they do that in the Blue Ridge, and they also do it on shorelines. So it's cool to go to Cape May, New Jersey, and you'll see the redtails up here, you'll see the sharp-shinned hawks here, you see the black kites up at that altitude, and here come the monarchs, and then the buckeyes below them. So you see all these different strata of migrants.
Very cool. You've seen monarchs crossing the Chesapeake, too. If you go along the eastern shore, there's a big raptor migration along the eastern shore.
Right.
Drive along the Chesapeake Bay Bridge Tunnel, and there'll be monarchs flying across the Chesapeake.
They've got to do it. They've got to get across. That's right. And they cross the Atlantic. They show up almost every year in the Isles of Scilly and the counties of Dorset, Devon, and Cornwall in England. And people
Was
say...
Were they established on the Azores?
Yes, they're established on the Azores. You're absolutely right. So some could come from there. Urquhart used to think that they would actually settle on the water and then take off again, and he'd hold them underwater and they could fly. There are some shipboard stowaways that have been recorded, but it's very likely that a lot of them just get on some pretty high winds and just get tossed.
The Perfidium can do it.
Yeah, exactly. Perfidium excellus, the the tiny pygmy blue, one of our most recent residents of this state. They go a long way on the wind, so monarchs good too. Any other questions? Yes.
I just wanted to say about fighting GMOs, and you said probably we can't prevail against.
Well, I shouldn't say we can.
Well,
might take
it's formidable.
I get it,
it's a long, long struggle, but I've been working in the natural foods industry for 40 years, and I first learned about GMOs in the late 80s, and only the small, you know, the world in which I work knows about them, and the larger public didn't, and I find that's beginning to change. And more people are getting the threat that GMOs represent. And, you know, for a long time, I've been involved in all these conservation organizations, and I've been involved in the natural foods industry. Everybody in the industry totally gets that organic agriculture is the best thing you could possibly, you know, I mean, like, it's a huge step forward for conservation of wildlife. But it doesn't always go the other way. You know, you got a lot of people, you know, eating junk food and not, like, thinking that it's important or saying organic's too expensive and not supporting the industry that's providing the alternative. And the more you support the industry that provides the alternative, the more alternatives there are. And it does. The reason why the USDA tries to undermine organic so much is because companies want in on it. They want the label to get the income without doing the work. So it's all of this matters, and what you choose to eat every day and what you purchase in the store matters, number one. And number two, you need to keep raising your voice and letting your legislators know what you think about GMOs, because it is beginning to get on the horizon. We've gone from a tiny percentage of the population even seeing it as a threat to maybe 10% sees it as a threat.
You're right. Spread the word.
Wasn't there actually, just recently, a scare because one of these manufacturers discovered that there was a GMO component to one of their cooperative ventures, and they were afraid that that was going to label them, and so they're even the big time people are worried about being associated with that.
That's right.
That's progress.
Yeah, and in recent days, a number of countries are holding off on their American wheat buy because of, and I didn't mean to sound defeatist by any means. And in fact, the whole small farmers market, big in my county, Wicaiquan County, small agriculture, is so heartening. It's heartening for our bodies, it's heartening for the butterflies. And it's that kind of a polyculture of small production, or even big production that allows a little bit of territory along the edges, which is what we used to have. And that's what they're working on in Britain a great deal. We've got very efficient agriculture. Allow a little bit of habitat on the edges can make a huge difference in the butterflies and the birds and everything else. So the monarch's a pretty resilient animal. When I first met Roger Torrey Peterson, we were talking about, he was very interested in butterflies and in their conservation. And he was really worried about the giant silk moths and how they'd been knocked down by the DDT in the 50s and the big lights and everything else. When we talked about monarchs, Roger used to say, the monarch now, they'll take care of themselves. Mm-hmm. And I wish that were the case. And I think that they are incredibly resilient. But just think of this. This is one animal that is what ecologists call an R species, in other words, a generalist, during part of its life, scattered all over the country, feeding on all kinds of milkweed, common and weedy. And then, at another time of its life, concentrated more than probably any other species on Earth. And then very vulnerable to fire, drought, etc., storm and everything. And so becomes the ultimate K species, or specialist like a spotted owl. A really, really interesting animal. And I don't know if David will or not have mentioned that he did a great deal of research on them in Australia when he was there, on the recently evolved monarch migration in Australia over 75 years or so. A lot of big study of papers that David's done there. And so people are looking at them all over the world. It's a great animal. We do have it in the Northwest. It's part of our fauna. It's not common. But let's revere it. Let's watch for it. Let's get our records down carefully. Oh, and sorry, got to go to bed. But weddings and wedding releases. If you know anybody who thinks that releasing monarchs at weddings or funerals or divorces or what else is a green thing to do, please try to have a word with them, because it's anything but. For various reasons. Some are offended, like Jeff Glassberg of NABBA, that it treats butterflies as baubles. You know, they don't have the dignity of a wild animal. And there's merit to that argument. Others are concerned about the genetics of it, mixing different genetic spots. But that's extraordinarily difficult to demonstrate. and probably a weak reed to try to fight on. And the same is true of disease spread. They may very well spread the various diseases of monarchs, some of which are pretty difficult diseases. They can be spread by monarchs that come from the hatcheries. However, the one thing that we can't argue against is the fact that when we spread monarchs around, we interfere with our picture of what they're really doing in nature. And you saw how we had a wrong picture for 50 years. And when we finally found out, not by doing any great science, but just going out and looking, it wasn't just me, various people going out and looking at what the monarchs were really doing, we revised that picture. But in order to conserve something, one of the great butterfly groups, TILS, stands for...
International Lepidopterist.
And their motto says, you cannot conserve what you do not know. And you've got to know where the monarchs are to conserve them, to understand them. So you can't do that if you're tossing them around the countryside willy-nilly. So, and fortunately, we finally got Washington and Oregon to both say that they will not issue permits for releases of commercial monarchs. It still happens because they ignore the law, but it's on the book. So
we're making. We can prosecute if we catch them?
Well, you get Ann to do it. Yeah, do a citizen's arrest. But we're getting there. So let's try to keep our monarchs natural and let's learn all we can about them. Thank you so much for having me.